information of the kinds and types. Yes, so the dimensions of containers, they're just updating you what dimensions. When they say dimensions, normally the dimensions, fine. The exterior dimensions and the interior dimensions are the two separate dimensions. And as you've read from the what a container is, certain keywords, you should not lose them throughout our 2 weeks stay here. Always remember, it's a standard equipment of transportation, okay? It's standardized, so it has got some unique and specific and common dimensions, be it the kind, the type, what sort of product is carried. The dimensions are universal and they are standardized. So they are constructing a steel container, whatever it is, by the manufacturing, the whatever company does it, they go according to specifications of the regulating authority, and that's the ISO. And they've also subletted certain considerations or regulations to another company called the BIC. Then there's another second company will come across as we go along. So it's not just any box, as I've been reiterating to you. It's not just any box. It's of standard specifications, and you don't go against it. If you go against it, it's no more a box fit for unit of transport. It could be drawn by the authorities. So they are saying containers are always marked. So that word marked is also a new word. If ideally we are all used to the custom of the trade, is this is the container number. Do you get it? Yeah, those alphanumerical identification things are called the identification marks, but we have used to container number. Nobody takes it away from you, but technically and according to the organizations that are to ensure, they say they've marked the container. It's just like the name of the individual unique container. No two containers should be the same. No, then there'll be confusion. It is their marks. That is their uniqueness. So when this container is being tracked, it's being traced during the voyages that it undertakes, it can be arrested, intercepted, or located exactly where he is. Those of us in the industry, if you are doing tracking and tracing the container history, you follow it vividly, wherever it is, what activity it is going through at any time, is so clear on the tracking and tracing websites. So it makes our work easy. You advise your clients is coming, but then what makes it unique? And two numbers are not assigned to two containers. That is it. So containers are marked, and they are not numbered, they are marked. Then apart from the main 11 alphanumeric we'll be concentrating on, they are also marked with the 10 and the gross weights on the dots. Okay? And we'll have an approximate weight, and they are even giving you the tons that will give you and a maximum gross weight of approximately 28 tons. So road hauling vehicles. So they've constructed road hauling vehicles being a specific standard unit to carry or transport the container also according to their specifications. So if you want, when we started enforcing our road hazard law, and those of you in the industry, I hope you witness it. Yes. So when you are going to hire a truck, when you weigh the empty truck before you are coming for the container, that is the tear weight. When we say tear weight and gross weight or the net weight in shipping, the first word, the tear, is any container that you are going to use for the unit as transportation. You should know the weight first when it is empty. Then you weigh the contents you are going to put in it to alone. So you add the two. So they give you the gross weight at the end of the day. Net there gives you gross, okay? You are interested in this because our road hazard regulations in every country differs. Ghana have got this, there's a table for it. So if you know you are going to load a certain container with certain items for export, they are going to transport the container from the emptiness from whichever port to the point of loading, okay, the items. So if the VGM we talked about yesterday involves only weight issues, yes, so we know the standard practices, vehicles of certain types should not weigh more than certain weight before they are allowed to travel on our roads. So if you watch, if you are now traveling along the corridors of Ghana, there are several highways that have got the Azeway bridges that they regulate and control. One is on the motorway. Those are the fixed ones. Sometimes when we're not constructing the road, we have the mobile ones. If you read the junction going into the Sakumono village, they were there. So when they started with the fixed one, drivers started avoiding the motorway and using. So quickly, the government imported the mobile as a weight scales, just to ensure that the maximum allowable weight for the vehicle with its contents should not exceed certain weights before they allow. Just for what? For the safety of our roads. If the roads are overused, they've invested to construct roads, maybe that road technically should exist for between 20 to 30 years. If you see how reckless that our roads have been racked within no time. 2, 3, 4, 5 years, our roads are gone. That's why the government find it difficult to come back, because it's so expensive and we use it recklessly. And if you watch, during the time the war broke out in Abidjan between 2001-2002, all their traffic business came to Tema. But the moment we started enforcing our as a weight law, you see, they all fled away, because where they were operating and where they came from, they have relaxed the law, you know, because we are in competition, ports. So certain countries say, together, Ghana, you enforce your as a road, we shall not do it. So a country like Abidjan, they relaxed it, so they went back. But when the war was there, they were compelled to come, because the environment was not safe. So the French speaking countries among themselves were wooing shippers to use their ports, because they said that is what they brought to our ports. You see how they have been loading, they are offloading. So that if you watch, that's the more reason they don't like going away with their containerized cargo in their containers. They like unstuffing, because they can unstuff more into a truck, because the tail weight of the container alone is minus the weight of the whole vehicle and the container and the contents. So these dimensions are legal standard dimensions you see. If you pick any container, then let me go back and see whether we can project one of the containers we saw that. I'll show you where you see those things. Good. Most of their weights, maximum, net and gross, are the things they list here. There's also another plate pasted, we are called the container safety plate. That one too has got very vital information about the container. Very vital information. The year of date of manufacture is there, the date it came into operation, and even maybe how many years is supposed, the duration is supposed to last, its lifespan. So the safety plates too, very, very important. And most of the dimensions of that just spoken briefly about are the things we see over here. It's only at the top here that you see what we have been calling the container number, which is called container identification mark. And under it, as I told you, the world is going so fast. They are digitizing everything. The size and the kind, the size and the type of kind of a container, they've coded it into 4 alphanumeric. So very soon you get the BL, everything, you will not be typing 1 by 40, then even, and then you write the cargo. The moment you put in the code, everybody who is in that trade knows what you are talking about. So that's at the overview of the dimension. So in it, you see net weight, gross weight, tail weight, what the container is meant for, its lifespan, and certain specific particulars about the container. So that container safety plate is very, very crucial. So you see it here. At times, if you open the door, you see it inside the door too. Yes, and at times, some of the inscriptions here are still imprinted inside portion of the door. Okay. So having said that, I'll just ask you a very simple question. this part, and this part, which one is the front and which one is the back of the container? You see, the doors are always here, okay? And the back is sealed. That part of the container is sealed. But these are the end where we open it. So those two sides of the container, which one is the front of the container and where, which one is the back of the container? Okay, she is saying where the doors are at the front of the container. So meaning he's inferring the string end is the back of the container, if I got you right. Any other? No, do all of you agree with her?
Yes.
Do you agree with her?
Yes.
You agree with her?
Yes.
Very good. Who said no?
You.
Okay, so what's your answer?
I think it's the other one. This is the back of the container where the doors are. And then the front is the other side.
That's correct. The string end before the chain is the back, is the front end of the container.
And this one here is the back end where the doors are. So that is the labeling of the container. The manufacturers or inventors, I don't know why, the totally sealed part is rather the front end. And where we open is the back end. So we always refer to this thing as the back end doors. Okay, good. So the certain dimensions or key figures are quoted in your notes, okay? This has come to intercept the dimensions and some other things we should be looking at. We'll continue, but I've intentionally jumped it and interface it with the container handling equipment so that you understand it, so that if you go to now to look at the various parts of the sealed container as it is, you understand. So any standard average container terminal, these are most of the handling equipments that you purchase. Yes. So which one we have in Ghana port, I'll let you know. The ones we don't have, I'll point it out.